This is Dr. Maria Anwar. Hope you guys are fine. Today we are going to discuss about the adrenocortical hormones. So adrenocortical hormones are those hormones which are actually released by the adrenal glands. Adrenal glands are the glands which are present above each of your kidneys. We grossly divide adrenal glands into the two parts. The outer parts is called the adrenal cortex and the inner part is known as the adrenal medulla. Now what's about the layers of the adrenal cortex? We divide the layers into the three parts. The outermost layer of the adrenal cortex is known as the zona glomerulosa. Middle layer is called zona fasciculata. And the innermost layer is known as zona reticularis. And the inner part, the most inner part of the whole adrenal gland is known as the medulla. Medulla is different from the adrenal cortex. Here you can see, this is the histology of your adrenal cortex. Here you can see, these are the cells of the zona glomerulosa, then zona fasciculata, and the innermost layer of the adrenal cortex is the zona reticularis. Now these are the cells of the medulla. How about the adrenocortical hormones? Grossly, we divide the adrenal cortical hormones into the three types. Number one, mineralocorticoid. Number two, glucocorticoid. And the last one is the androgenic hormones. So what are the mineralocorticoids? Mineralocorticoids are those hormones which are involved with the regulations of the minerals and salts and eventually water. There are different kinds of mineralocorticoid. The most potent mineralocorticoid is aldosterone. We will discuss it later in our lectures. Another type of mineralocorticoid is deoxycorticosterone. Then there is corticosterone, 9-alpha, corticosol, cortisol, and cortisone. Now keep in mind, though all of these are mineralocorticoid, but only aldosterone has the most potent activity, and then there are other mineralocorticoids, though they do have mineralocorticoid activity, but their mineralocorticoid activity is not as potent as compared to the aldosterone. Corticosterone and 9-alpha cortisol, they are synthetic. It means they are not naturally produced in the body. Now here you can also see the cortisol. Cortisol, though we broadly classify it under the classification of glucocorticoid, but cortisol also has mineralocorticoid activity when it is secreted in the large amounts. Now we move to the glucocorticoids. Glucocorticoids are those hormones which are involved in the metabolism of the fats, lipids, and proteins. The most potent glucocorticoid is the cortisol. Then we have other glucocorticoids, for example, corticosterone, cortisone, prednisone, methylprednisone, dexamethasone. Now all these cortisone, prednisone, methylprednisone, and dexamethasone, these are synthetically produced. Cortisol is naturally produced and it is most potent in naturally in human body. But these synthetic glucocorticoids, for example, cortisone, methylprednisone, and dexamethasone, they are more potent as compared to the cortisol, which is produced naturally. You guys must have known about the different drugs which use the steroid to control the inflammatory reactions. So these are those drugs, dexamethasone, methylprednisone, prednisone. Later on we will find out that they are involved in the control of the inflammation. So that's why they are used in the pharma industry. The last hormone of the adrenal cortex are the androgenic hormone, or you can also call them sex hormones. They are of different types, for example, the hydroepiandrosterone, androstenedione, estrogens, and glucocorticoids. Though glucocorticoids are broadly classified under the obviously all glucocorticoids, for example cortisol, cortisone, but they also have the androgenic activity. Now you guys do have remembered they also have the mineralocorticoid activity and they also have the androgenic activity. Later on when we will discuss about the pathologies, then we will see that whenever there is an excess of glucocorticoids or there is a deficiency of glucocorticoids, it not only affects the glucocorticoid activity but also the mineralocorticoid and androgenic activity. Here I take you back again to the layers. Here you can see the zona glomerulosa majorly produced aldosterone, which is involved in the mineralocorticoid activity. The zona fasciculata is majorly involved in the production of cortisol, corticosterone. In the zona glomerularis, it is involved in the formation of androgens or the sex hormones. Now, how are adrenocortical hormones are synthesized? Adrenocortical hormones, they need ACTH. ACTH is the adrenocorticotropic release hormone. They have the receptors on the cell membrane, which is cyclic AMP G protein coupled receptor. As you guys have already discussed about the mechanism of actions of different hormones, so I'm not going into the detail, but you know the cyclic AMP eventually produces the protein kinase A. Now I take you to this picture. Here you can see that protein kinase A, it eventually affects on the cholesterol. Here you can see the cholesterol which is present in the lipid droplet. Now that cholesterol is converted into the pregnenolone. Conversion of cholesterol to the pregnenolone is a rate limiting step which is determined by the hormone known as desmolase. Again I repeat it, ACTH, it has receptors on the cell membrane. Then ACTH eventually cause the conversion of cholesterol into the pregnenolone through a late rate limiting step by enzyme desmolase. Now the pregnenolone, it can either follow this path, 2-progesterone, 11-deoxycorticosterone, corticosterone, 18-hydroxycorticosterone, and eventually aldosterone, which is a mineralocorticoid. Or the pregnenolone can take this part by the action of 17-alpha-hydroxylase, it will convert into the 17-hydroxypregnenolone, or then they can eventually form the cortisone, which is a glucocorticoid. Here you can see it is also the cortisol, which is a your main major cortisol, and this is a cortisone. So these are all glucocorticoids. Then again the pregnenolone, it can cause the formation of different enzymes, and through the different enzyme it can form the dihydrotestosterone, estriol, and these are all androgens. Estrogens and androgens, these are all sex hormones. So you can see the ACTH causes the formation of mineralocorticoid, glucocorticoids and androgens. It forms it through the cholesterol, a late limiting step from the desmolase enzyme. Now go back to the previous picture again. Here again you can see ACTH, it has receptor on the cell membrane, which is a G protein coupled receptor, and through the cyclic AMP it causes the formation of protein kinase A. Protein kinase A, it converts the effect acts on the cholesterol, and cholesterol is converted into the pregnenolone. Then the reactions occur in the mitochondria, and eventually the different adrenocortical hormones are produced and they are transported back into the bloodstream. Today we are going to discuss about the adrenal medulla. We have already discussed about the adrenal cortex, and the inner part of the adrenal gland is known as the adrenal medulla, and it is 20% of the whole gland. It has number of secretions, that is norepinephrine, epinephrine, dopamine, opioid peptides and adrenomedulin. You can see the synthesis of the epinephrine, norepinephrine and dopamine. It starts from the tyrosine, and due to the effect of tyrosine hydroxylase enzyme, it is converted into the DOPA, which is converted into the dopamine. Sorry for that. And then through the effect of enzyme dopamine beta hydroxylase, it is converted into the norepinephrine. To convert it into the epinephrine, it requires an enzyme phenylethanolamine and methyltransferase. It is only present in the adrenal medulla. So the adrenal medulla can convert the norepinephrine into the epinephrine. All the secretions of both epinephrine and norepinephrine, 80% is the epinephrine and 20% is the norepinephrine. Half-life is 2 to 4 minutes and epinephrine has 5 to 10 times as great metabolic effect as norepinephrine. Though it can be destroyed with the presence of monoamine oxidase to a compound known as 3-methoxy-4-hydroxymandelic acid. This is also used for a condition in which there is abnormal or abundant production of epinephrine or norepinephrine. Here you can see the levels of methyl mandelic acid. It has different functions. For example, all functions which are related to the sympathetic nervous system, that is increased heart rate, contractility, inotropism, comatropism, tomatropism. It dilates the vessels in the skeletal muscles during exercise, and it constricts the vessels in the skin and the GIT. Though it increases the gluconeogenesis and glycogenolysis, and it also stimulates the sweating, and it dilates the pupil as in fight and flight response, and it inhibits secretions and the activity of GIT. You can see the effects of epinephrine and norepinephrine through different receptors. As you know, there are different adrenergic receptors, alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1, beta 2, beta 3. So here I have mentioned, for example, in heart, they increases the heart rate, contractility, AV nodal conduction with the effect of beta 1 receptor. In vascular smooth muscle, it constricts the vessel with the help of alpha 1 and it dilates the vessel through the beta 2 receptors in the skeletal muscles. In GIT, it decreases the motility through alpha 2 and beta 2 and constricts the sphincters through alpha 1. Bronchioles, it causes the dilation of the bronchioles through the beta 2 receptors, and it causes the ejaculation and relaxation of the bladder wall through alpha, beta 2 and beta 1 receptors, and it increases sweating through the sympathetic cholinergic. Here it is the cholinergic, nor the epinephrine or norepinephrine. And in kidney, you can see it increases the renin secretion through beta 1, and in fat cell, it increases the lipolysis through the beta 1. There are some non-hemodynamic effects of the catecholamine. For example, it causes the monocyte activation and modulation of inflammation. Though it also causes the containment of inflammatory response, so that your response is not spread to the each and every organ of the body. So because if it is spread to the all organs of the body, or it is a systemic inflammation, it can be harmful to the body. Again, as I've already mentioned, it has effect on different energy metabolic processes. For example, it activates the Cori cycle, it increases glycogenolysis, gluconeogenesis, it increases glycolysis, ketogenesis, lipolysis, proteolysis, and in mitochondria enhances oxygen and metabolic substrate availability. So there are different functions, or basically these are sympathetic nervous system function which occur through the epinephrine and norepinephrine. Another receptors, alpha 1 receptor, it has effect through both epinephrine and norepinephrine. It is sensitive to both of them equally. It works through the inositol triphosphate mechanism through the GQ receptors. Then alpha 2 receptor, it also responds epinephrine to norepinephrine equally, and it works through the GI proteins, and it decreases the cyclic AMP. So it is basically inhibitory. Beta 1, it also responds to epinephrine and norepinephrine equally, but its response, beta 1 receptors are more sensitive to epinephrine and norepinephrine than alpha 1 receptors. and it works through the GS proteins and it increases the cyclic AMP. Beta 2 receptor, yes, is response to both epinephrine and norepinephrine, but its effect is mainly due to the epinephrine, not through the norepinephrine. Its mechanism of action is same. It is through the GS proteins and it increases the cyclic AMP. About the dopamine, again, it also has function which are similar to those of the epinephrine and norepinephrine. But here I've just mentioned some of them, which are renal vasodilation in mesentery, increase heart rate, increase systolic pressure. As it is involved in the heart rate and systolic pressure, it is a part of the life-saving drug. So it is very useful in the shock, the cardiogenic shock, and also circulatory shock and all the traumatic condition where there is low blood volume and low blood pressure. So this effect is, this drug is life-saving drug. Now the pheochromocytoma is basically abnormality. It is a tumor that arises from the chromaffin cells. They are present in the adrenal medulla. These are the cell which causes the release of epinephrine and norepinephrine. So whenever there is a tumor, there will be more release of epinephrine and more norepinephrine, and the effects of all the sympathetic effect will increase. For example, patient will be having high blood pressure, increased sweating, tachycardia, palpitation, and headache. The only treatment available for that is the surgical removal of the tumor.